head tilted to the side, dead in his bedroom at 100 North Carrollwood. We know during this time frame, June 24th, 2009, what Michael was doing. He was rehearsing, he was practicing, he was preparing for one of the biggest tours of his career. And we know now from hearing all the evidence in this case about his outlook on the future, what he planned to do, what he planned for his family, what he planned for his business future. We know he was optimistic. Was he anxious about the tour? Absolutely certain he was. He's a 50-year-old man embarking on one of the biggest tours of his career, 50 sold-out shows at the O2 Arena in London. Who wouldn't be anxious about that? He wanted to satisfy his fans, his family, his children. He was a creative genius and a perfectionist, and he went about these tasks striving for perfection, striving to perform at the top of his level, striving to satisfy the fans that had been so loyal to him for so many years. And he wanted perfection, and he wanted to be the best. And despite any normal anxieties he may have had about that endeavor, he was optimistic, he was excited, he was looking to the future. We know October 2008 that he had relayed to Randy Phillips. If you recall, they were at the Bel Air Hotel before Michael had moved into 100 North Carrollwood. The children were there running around in Halloween masks and costumes playing, and that's how one of the reasons Randy Phillips remembered that it was October, because it was near Halloween. And Michael had expressed that he didn't want to be a vagabond anymore. He'd been traveling. He wanted to buy a nice house for his children. He wanted to settle down. He was looking toward the future. He was making plans, long-term plans, for both himself and his three children, to whom he was so dedicated. We learned about the tour and what Michael hoped to accomplish with this tour and why it was important to him. Kenny Ortega told us how this environmental message of Michael's had always been so important. And it resonated through his songs, not just his own personal beliefs, but his messages to the public, to the lyrics in his songs. And this was profoundly important to him. And he wanted to share this message. He wanted to express this voice throughout this tour. He wanted to repay his fans and, again, do a top level performance in gratitude to his fans for all their years of loyalty and support. And probably most importantly, he wanted to do it for his children, who had not seen their father put on such a performance. And he wanted them to come see what he does so well. He wanted his children to see what he has spent his whole life doing, being creative, being a performer, being an entertainer. He wanted his children to experience that, and that was one of the foundations for his desire to go forward with this tour. We know his children were paramount to him. One of the things he'd expressed to Randy Phillips that part of the deal they had, he wanted a large estate in London while the tour took place, because he didn't want the children to be cooped up in a hotel room. He didn't want the family to be trapped in a hotel surrounded by paparazzi. So he wanted a large estate with streams and horses and animals so his kids could leave as normal a life as possible while this tour unfolded. We knew about his future plans to make movies. He wanted to make a feature-length film based on the song Thriller in the video Thriller. He discussed other movies. He wanted to get into directing. He had plans. He had hopes. He had dreams, as we all do, both for himself and his family. We heard about his desire to open a children's hospital. We heard this not only from the drugged recording, of May 10th, 2009 at 9:05 in the morning. But in Conrad Murray's own statement to the police, he comments that Michael wanted to create this children's hospital, to give this to the world. That Conrad Murray said he was hoping, or he had been asked, to be the medical director of this children's hospital. Michael had plans and hopes and dreams. We knew also that the tour had been discussed that the tour following this successful leg in London, these 50 shows, it was hoped that it would expand across the world, go through the United States. Again, there were plans and dreams and hopes that were very well known to those around Michael Jackson during this time. But we also know, as we heard from multiple witnesses, that what was paramount to Michael were his three children. And his dreams and hopes were intertwined with those same dreams and hopes that he aspired for his three kids. One of the reasons he was so excited about the tour, if you recall, was because it was going to be beginning that summer, and the kids, relieved from the obligations of school, would be able to accompany him and go on the tour and see their dad perform in London. But none of this came to be. None of these dreams, hopes, aspirations, or desires came to be, because on June 25th, 2009, Michael Jackson, just 50 years old, was pronounced dead. We know, and we will discuss, the circumstances of that death. We know, and we'll discuss, how Paris had to come in and see her father in that condition and scream out, "Daddy," as she broke down in tears. How Prince had a shocked look on his face, and was crying. That's what the actions of Conrad Murray did, not just to Michael Jackson, but to his children. Ladies and gentlemen, the defendant is charged with one single count of involuntary manslaughter for the criminal negligence that was exhibited and caused the death of Michael Jackson. I want to talk to you briefly about the law and the applicability of the law in this case. The law as it relates to involuntary manslaughter. And I want you to remember, if you look back whenever it was, 6 weeks ago or thereabouts, when I stood in this very well and we were going through voir dire, and I discussed with each and every one of you, I said, you may have unanswered questions at the end of this trial. There may be 100 questions, and maybe 97 of them are left unanswered. But under the law, you need only answer just 3. I ask each and every one of you, are you the type of juror that could do that? Are you the type of juror that could follow the law, recognize that you have an extremely important role, but also a limited role, to answer the questions presented by the law? And I asked you, in all candor, are you the type of juror that would just be frustrated? You need to answer everything or you cannot reach a verdict. And each and every one of you assured me that you would be able to follow the law, determine the facts,